This is a water droplet that you're going to see. And in this water droplet, a frequency is being pumped into this water droplet. As the frequency is mirrored in the droplet, you'll actually see the geometric patterns in that droplet. Now, what's happening, and the reason that this is so significant, is because we're going to do a frequency sweep. We're going to go from low frequencies to higher frequencies. And what you'll find is this. You'll see that in the lower frequencies, the patterns are less complex. And in the higher frequency, the patterns are more complex. So we're going through a sweep from lower to higher frequency. I'm sharing this with you now because Earth is essentially going through a frequency sweep. Our fundamental pulse, our base pulse that has hovered around 7.8 cycles per second, now is changing. And again, there's a lot of controversy about what the change is, and we're witnessing the change. As we go through our planetary shift of this pulse, patterns of energy must change to respond to that, just as patterns of energy in this water are changing to respond to this pulse. And we'll begin with simply the concentric patterns in the water as the frequency begins. Every once in a while, we'll reach a key threshold resonance, such as that moment right there. And in that key threshold resonance, the entire pattern morphed into a more complex expression of itself, simply because the frequency changed. Now watch what happens. The frequency is still increasing. Now watch what happens. As we reach another key threshold resonance, this entire pattern will morph into a beautifully and more complex pattern of itself. Again, and again. And look at this pattern right here. Look what you're seeing right here. Look at the beautiful geometry. Here is a perfect cube. There's a perfect tetrahedron, a star tetrahedron. In two dimensions, we've got the octahedron. Very powerful images of sacred geometry held in place simply because we've achieved the vibratory pattern that allows that in this water droplet. And as the vibration increases, these patterns will become more and more complex. You can see the pulse from where you are. Can you see the pulse actually in the water? As we go into the last set of the frequencies, what you'll see is that the entire, and you'll watch along the outer perimeter, the entire pattern reaches its greatest level of complexity, and then it goes back. As the frequencies drop, it goes back to what it was, the concentric circles, as it was originally. It almost looks alive. You know, you've been offered many times the concept that thought is vibration. Have you ever considered that emotion is vibration? Feeling is vibration. We are always feeling something. We are always emoting something. We may not always be aware of what that is. We carry those patterns with us. As we hold a feeling and an emotion, what we're doing is we are holding a vibratory pattern in the liquid crystal of our bodies.
Feel has now been scientifically shown to be provable. And what you're going to see now are what happens to particles of sand and other various particles when a sound resonates across a plate and resonates those particles in tune with the sound. Because when we think, we're not just sending out a wave which resonates the energy, we're sending out on a frequency outside of the range of human hearing, we're sending out a sound. Everything is sound. When we think a sound goes out, it resonates the energy around us to that sound. And what you're about to see are some pictures that show this happening when sound is introduced and how sound takes random particles and turns it into astonishing form. And that's how this universe was created. In the beginning was the Word. the word was sound. So what you're looking at here is merely particles formed into patterns by sound. They were all over the place to start with, just in random positions on the plate. As soon as the sound appears, they form into these patterns, because everything is sound, and it is sound that turns matter and energy into form. Patterns on wings of birds and insects are all the manifestation of the sound vibrations. Every organ in our body resonates to a certain frequency, and when our thoughts and emotions and stress and the vibrations that that causes de-harmonize the vibrational state of our various parts of our body, we become ill. So we think ourselves into illness because we're affecting the vibrational state of the body. And so every time you think and feel, you're resonating a frequency which is making the energy around you resonate to the same frequency. What you give out is what you create. Here you're seeing mini galaxies just formed by particles and sound. This is how the galaxies and the universe and the solar systems were formed and continue to be held in the structure they're in through sound. If the sound changes, the matter changes, the energy changes. So when you look at what it says in texts like even the Old Testament, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was sound. And sound is everything. When you think and feel, you're creating sound. This is how the heart beats at a certain resonance. All you're looking at here are interacting frequencies making a beat. And so while the frequency of the heart is at the right level, beats in the normal number of beats a minute. But when we become stressed, we affect that frequency and the heart beats faster. And so everything is sound, even the human heartbeat and the interacting frequencies that make it happen. And we've seen the galaxies, and now here are the planets forming, just on a plate from particles caused by sound passing through them. This planet has a resonant frequency. It's called the Schumann cavity resonance. But basically, while that frequency holds, the planet will hold its present form. If the frequency changes, the form will change. It's the same with everything. And here you see sound being passed through iron filings and particles, and therefore creating form once again. And from these pictures, it's hardly difficult to see how the human body is formed through sound resonating energy, and how that physical form is held as long as that sound matrix is held. But once that changes, the physical body changes. So there you've seen, with stunning effect, how sound creates form, how galaxies are created, how planets are created. And all those planets, balls of particles, all those revolving galaxies were merely particles turned into that form by sound.
This next series of photographs are the work of Japanese researcher Mr. Masaru Emoto from his book, The Message from Water. Mr. Emoto's work provides factual evidence that human vibrational energy, thoughts, words, ideas, and music affect the molecular structure of water. Please remember that water comprises over 70% of a mature human body and covers the same amount on our planet. Water is the very source of all life. This photo shows the beautifully formed geometric design of the Yushi Spring water. This next photo is from the Shimanto River, the last clean spring in Japan. Notice the extraordinary geometric forms. The fact that the molecular structure of water can be affected by our consciousness, our intent, and our sounds is extremely important. This photo is from the Mount Cook Glacier in New Zealand. Mr. Emoto has been visually documenting these molecular changes in water by means of his photographic techniques. He freezes droplets of water, then examines them under a dark field microscope that has photographic capabilities. His work clearly demonstrates the diversity of the molecular structure of water and the effects of the environment upon the structure of the water. This photo is from the fountain in Lourdes, France. This photo is from contaminated water from the Yodo River in Japan. In this photo, we can compare the contaminated water with clean stream water. Look at the difference. Mr. Emoto decided to see what effects music would have upon the structure of water. He placed distilled water between two speakers for several hours while playing different music and then photographing the crystals that formed after the water was frozen. This photo is of water being exposed to Beethoven's Pastorale. This photo is the effect of Bach's Air for the G-string on the water. This photo is water exposed to Chopin's Farewell Song. This next photo is water being exposed and affected to music that was designed for healing. This photo is of water being exposed to the Kawachi folk dance. This photo shows the effect of heavy metal music upon the water. Here now we can compare the effects of healing versus heavy metal music and what happens to the water molecules. Mr. Emoto decided to see how thoughts and words affected the formation of untreated distilled water crystals by typing words onto paper and then taping this paper onto glass bottles overnight. This photo shows the effects of the words, "Thank you." This next photo shows the effects of the words, "Love and appreciation." This photo shows the effects of the words, "You make me sick, I will kill you." And here we can compare the effects of "thank you" with the "you make me sick, I will kill you." Very, very different geometric forms being incurred through the intention. Now this photo is of a very polluted and toxic water from the Fujiwara Dam. Here now is the same water from the Fujiwara Dam after a Buddhist monk had offered a prayer over it. Prayer, that sound coupled with intention, seems to have an extraordinary ability of restoring water to its natural, harmonious, geometric symmetry. And in this photo we can compare the toxic water and then the effects of praying over the water It's really quite impressive. These photographs that we have just seen show proof that not only does sound have the ability of affecting and changing physical structure, but that with regard to the molecular structure of water, that our intent with our sound is extremely important. This may have great implications for the future of both personal and planetary harmony and healing.
To what extent is water capable of picking up information? What does it perceive? And how does it remember it over time?
The Aerospace Institute in Stuttgart has discovered a relatively simple way of making the structure of a drop of water visible. The researchers have had their efforts rewarded by insights into a very beautiful world. Each drop has a face of its own, unmistakable and unique. Why are the individual drops so different from one another? We got a lot of people to come to a lecture hall here at the Institute, gave them all the same water, had them make drops at exactly the same time, collected all the drops, and then discovered that each individual produced different images from the same water. And here you can see the results. Here on the right you can see that the images of the individual students are different, but those made by a given student are all quite similar. This is the work of the first experimenter, this one here from the second, this from the third, and this from the fourth. Individually, they can quite easily be reproduced, but you would never have thought that they were all from the same water, because when you compare the images from the different people, you see some big differences. Then we undertook experiments to find out whether things changed when we put something into the water. A real flower was placed in the water. A while later, we took a drop of water, and here you can see one of the pictures. And you can see it in this picture. It's the typical image you get when you put a flower into water. You could recognize the flower in every single drop in this glass, of course. That can be reproduced and has significance. And if you were to put a different flower in here, for example, a Sweet William flower, then all the drops of this water would look like Sweet William. The statement that water has a memory practically changes our whole way of looking at the world, of course. Let's travel down the Rhine in the figurative sense. The water is flowing down the Rhine, picking up information everywhere it goes. So the water has more information at the mouth of the Rhine than it had at the source. And the Dutch, living at the mouth, when they drink that water, they're also drinking all that information. Thus, the world's oceans would no longer be something that separates us, but instead a giant storehouse of information, and the rain would perhaps be a data medium carrying information to the world.
Now, Mr. Emoto speaks of the thought or intent being the driving force in all of this. The science of how that actually affects the molecules is unknown, except to the water molecules, of course. And it's really fascinating when you keep in mind that 90% of our bodies are water.
Makes you wonder, doesn't it? If thoughts can do that to water, imagine what our thoughts can do to us. This is what it is, okay? I said, empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now, you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now, water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
At our galaxy. There are 100 billion stars in our galaxy. Now take a look at the galaxies of the universe. We can actually count them. In the visible universe, our telescopes have the range to see 100 billion galaxies. Well, how many stars are there in the visible universe? Count them. 100 billion times 100 billion. That is an astronomical number. You have to be supremely arrogant to believe that we are the only ones in town.
Here we are, 25,000 light years away from the center of our galaxy, and our galaxy is over 100,000 light years across. But even that, as large as it is kind of a speck in the cosmic distance scale.
Our Milky Way galaxy may appear big to us, but compared to some others out there, it's actually pretty small.
Come around here and let me have a look at you. My goodness, look at you. You turned out all right, didn't you? How do you feel? Let's get the obvious stuff out of the way.
You're not human, right?
Well, it's tough to get any more obvious than that.
If I had to guess, I'd say you're a program from the machine world. So is he.
So far, so good.
But if that's true, that could mean you're a part of the system. Another kind of control.
Keep going.
I suppose the most obvious question is, how can I trust you?
Bingo. It is a pickle, no doubt about it. Bad news is there's no way if you can really know whether I'm here to help you or not. So it's really up to you. Just have to make up your own damn mind to either accept what I'm going to tell you or reject it. Candy?
There are multitudes of cultures and societies that exist throughout the vastness of space. And these societies and cultures have been on and off this planet from the very beginning. It is not just that we, the Pleiadians, have come to assist. We are only one grouping from one star system. There are many who have journeyed here for many reasons. The majority of the extraterrestrials are here for your upliftment. Though there are also those who are here for other reasons. We give our version of things only to bring you into higher consciousness. We do not wish to say that this version and only this version is how it is. This whole teaching is designed with a great purpose in mind, and the stories that we tell you are set up to take you to a higher plane of consciousness. That is our intention. You are magnificent beings, members of the family of light, and you come to Earth at this time on assignment to create a shift, to make a change, to assist in the transition. You were told before you came here that there would be much assistance and that at different junctures of your development, different entities would present themselves upon the planet in different capacities to trigger you, fire you up, and remind you, not to do it for you. We are one of those triggers, a catalyst. When you hear the name Pleiadians, you feel a connection because we are assisting you in bringing your own information, your own knowing forward. You yourself chose to be here. You are on assignment to bring memory forward and to bring the value of human existence back to the forefront of creation. You are needed. You have been in training for this assignment for lifetimes, and you did not come unprepared. All that you need to know now is inside of you, and it is your task to remember your training. This is not a lifetime when you are going to be taught new information. As we said before, this is the lifetime when you are going to remember what you already know, and we are just here to remind you of it. That is part of our assignment. Humanity is an experiment. Humanity has been designed, as has just about everything else that exists within creation. Prime Creator began experimenting with creation a long time ago in this universe for the purpose of greater self-exploration, self-gratification, and self-expression. Prime Creator brought energies and essences of life, extensions of itself, into this universe and endowed those extensions with the gifts that it had. Prime Creator said to these extensions of itself, "Go out and create and bring all things back to me." Earth was a beautiful place, located on the fringes of one of the galactic systems and easily reached from other galaxies. It was close to many way portals, the highways that exist for energies to travel throughout space. Some of the creator gods were master geneticists. The master geneticists designed various species, some human, some animal, by playing with the varieties of DNA that the sentient civilizations contributed to make Earth into this exchange center of information, this light center. This living library. The original planners of Earth were members of the Family of Light, beings who worked for and were associated with an aspect of consciousness called light. They designed a place where galaxies would contribute their information and where all would be able to participate and share their specific knowledge. Earth was to be a cosmic library, a place of incredible beauty that experimented with how information could be stored through frequencies and through the genetic process. The project of the Living Library on Earth was eventually fought over. During Earth's early history, there were wars in space for ownership of this planet. Skirmishes took place, and Earth became a place of duality. Certain creator gods who had the right to do whatever they wanted, because Earth is a free will zone, came in and took over. When the skirmish occurred, a certain group of entities fought in space and won the territory of Earth. These new owners did not want the native Earth species, the humans, to be informed of what took place. Uninformed, the species would be easier to control. That is why light is information and darkness is lack of information. These entities beat out light and Earth became their territory. These new owners who came here 300,000 years ago are the magnificent beings spoken of in your Bible, in the Babylonian and Sumerian tablets, and in texts all over the world. They came to Earth and rearranged the native human species. They rearranged your DNA in order to have you broadcast within a certain limited frequency band whose frequency could feed them and keep them in power. They worked in their laboratories and created versions of humans with a different DNA, the two-stranded double helix DNA. The original DNA pattern was left within the human cells, yet it was not functional. It was split apart, unplugged. We, as Pleiadians, came back through time into what would perhaps be called our past. We came back in order to share a frequency with you, a frequency that each one of you has agreed to carry on this planet in order to change the DNA of the rearranged human race. Earth is assisting, in its own way, the evolution of the universe. It is where the plan begins to blossom, and what happens on Earth is going to affect many, many worlds. The creator gods who have been ruling this planet had the ability to become physical, though mostly they exist in other dimensions. They keep Earth in a certain vibrational frequency while they create emotional trauma to nourish themselves. There are some beings who honor life before everything else. And there are also beings who do not honor life, and do not understand their connection to it. Who are these beings who came in and rent asunder the original plans for Earth? Who are these space beings we sometimes refer to as the dark t-shirts? These space beings are part human and part reptilian. We call them the Lizzies because we like to make things a little less emotional and a little humorous so that you don't take them so seriously and get so upset. We are not here to frighten you. We are here to inform you. They have fed off your emotions. One of the big secrets that has been kept from you as a species is the richness and wealth that accompanies emotion. You have been steered away from exploring emotion because through emotion you can figure things out. Your emotions connect you with the spiritual body. The spiritual body, of course, is non-physical, existing on the multidimensional sphere. Why are we telling you all this? Why do you need to know it? You need to know it because the Lizzie reality is re-entering and merging with your dimension. As you awaken to your history, you will begin to open your ancient eyes. These are the eyes of Horus, which see not through the eyes of a human being, but from the point of view of a god. They see the connectedness and purpose of all things, for the ancient eyes are able to see into many realities and to connect the whole picture, the whole history. All of this is to be felt. Allow your brain cells to click into being without your rational conscious mind wanting to define things down to the most minute detail. This experience involves raising a feeling inside yourself, and then one day, at one moment, in one afternoon, having an overwhelming sense of knowing, having a composition of 1,000 pages long come alive in 5 seconds of divine ecstasy. Before you came into the body, all of you committed to designing events that would fire your codings or blueprints, that would activate your memories. Then you came into the body and you forgot. All of you have had your blueprints and codings fired to some extent because you understand that there is a divine purpose or divine plan that you are a part of. You hold the history of the universe within your physical body. What is occurring upon the planet now is the literal mutation of your physical body, for you are allowing it to be evolved to a point where it will be a computer that can house this information. The firing of the codings and the realization of your identity are going to become phenomenally intense. The reason for this is the evolving DNA. When you have 12 helixes of DNA in place, those helixes will begin to plug into the 12 chakra system. The 12 chakras are vortex centers loaded with information that you must be able to translate. You have to become super beings in whatever reality you enter because, as members of the Family of Light, the branch of renegades, this is your forte. As members of the Family of Light, you know the inside scoop. You come as ambassadors to make realities merge and become more informed within themselves so that everyone involved can release fear and become uninhibited. As you grow and come to these higher realms of recognition, you will break through what feels like cement blocks, layers of yourself that have held you down. Think of the frequency that has limited the human experiment as a radio station. The human experiment has had one radio station on for 300,000 years. Same old tunes. The human experiment was unable to turn the dial and hear a different band, so the same frequency was broadcast. This created a quarantine, a sealing off of this planet. The creative cosmic rays sent by Prime Creator and the original planners pierce through this frequency shield. They bombard Earth. However, they must have someone to receive them. Without a receptacle, these creative cosmic rays would create chaos and confusion. You, as members of the Family of Light, come into this system to receive these rays of knowledge. You then disseminate the knowledge, the new lifestyle, and the new frequency to the rest of the population to alter the entire planet. The ultimate tyranny in a society is not control by martial law. It is control by the psychological manipulation of consciousness through which reality is defined so that those who exist within it do not even realize that they are in prison. They do not even realize that there is something outside of where they exist. We represent what is outside of what you have been taught exists. It is where you sometimes venture and where we want you to dwell. It is outside of where society has told you you can live. What we want more than anything else is to assist you, as members of the Family of Light, to succeed in liberating the humans. Focus on the dance of yourself. To what tune will you dance, and to what magic will you perform? And to what heights will you be willing to push consciousness to give it a new definition of possibilities? Members of the Bringers of the Dawn or Family of Light work in teams. You don't go into systems alone. You need each other to do this work because you cannot hold the frequency by yourself. By going in as teams, you increase the odds of successfully carrying out the plan. You are like rays and light spirals of the central sun that are very intelligent, and you are guided by a great intelligence inside the central sun. The members of the Family of Light are much more than human. Characteristically, you are supreme achievers in the multidimensional realm. One applies for a position in the multidimensional realm as a member of the Family of Light. If you were to have a business card printed up for yourselves when you are in full memory of your identity, it would say something like, Renegade Member of Family of Light, Systems Buster, available for altering systems of consciousness within the free will universe, on call.
I'm going to show them a world without you. A world without rules and controls, without borders or boundaries. A world where anything is possible.
We speak to you as if you are not human, because to us, you are not. To us, you are members of the Family of Light, and we know your multidimensional selves. We speak to you about dealing with humans, because it is your assignment to integrate with them, soothe them, and awaken a spark of light within them, so that they are not all destroyed, and so that this place can house a new species and a new realm of activity. Our final words include a thank you to all of you who recognize the light source that is a part of your identity and that moves you to follow the silent whispers that echo down the golden spirals through the corridors of your own being. We honor you, we recognize you, and we are here to assist you. We are all here as the Family of Light to bring that choice and that freedom to evolve back onto this planet. Family of Light. Wake up.
We have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order.
We just need to take it back from this level of division, apartness, cardness, to isness, I amness, I am all that is, ever has been, and ever will be-ness.
Some people might not know exactly who the Pleiadians were.
They're here to rescue the human beings who are being enslaved on this planet and forced into a paradigm of a super oligarchy.
This is the level of the transformation. This is the level of the revolution, if you want to call it that. It's not guns, it's consciousness.
What a mind job. So you're here to save the world. What do you say to something like that?
In order to walk among us, they disguise their appearance by cloning human flesh of their own reptilian skin. I thought everyone here was up to speed. But the visitors didn't just get here. They've been here for years.
This completion has been heralded by many for eons. What happens on Earth now will affect the entire universe.
Thank you. Throughout time, there have been intersecting moments when the cycles of the great cosmic clocks line up in such a way that we're not only given a glimpse of all that is possible, but we actually have the opportunity to step beyond all that we've known as truth and participate in a grander truth within a higher level of consciousness.
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 Out of this vibrant nothingness emerged matter, energy, space, time, consciousness.
Consciousness.
That they're all connected.
I was no longer a fragment of the universe. I was the universe.
As 6.2 plus billion people of the Earth witness unprecedented changes in their world.
It's more and more obvious to people that there's a shift going on, a planetary shift.
We are the generation of hope. We are the generation of hope. Another me, another dream.
You cannot escape the responsibility of tomorrow by evading it today.
Quantum physics reveals that it's the invisible stimuli that are much more important. There's a simple quote by Albert Einstein that makes sense out of this, and the quote is, "The field is the sole governing agency of the particle." What Einstein meant by this very simply is the field, the invisible energy forces around us. They are the sole governing agencies of the particle, the particles matter. And so quantum physics says the character of matter is ultimately determined by the field.
If we were ever going to interact with our bodies, if we want to heal our bodies, we want to create peace in our families or our communities, we must speak to the fields that connect all things. We must find a meaningful language, a non-verbal language that communicates with the stuff that this world is made of. The bottom line, the through line, is that they're all speaking about an experience. An inner experience that we have focused on our hearts. What the science now is showing is that those experiences extend beyond our bodies into the world around us, because the field of our heart is part of the world around us and connected with that field. So that when individuals can find a way to create coherence in their lives and become more cooperative, less aggressive, more willing to solve problems together, that experience is transmitted in this field, and others begin to find the same experience just because they're in that field. They're in that field.
This
chart shows a dotted line going up and down, which is the rise and fall on a daily basis of the number of people who are meditating as a group in Jerusalem. It's all on a volunteer basis. And the solid line represents progress towards peace in the war in neighboring Lebanon. And even before the benefit of statistical analysis, you can almost see from the raw data that progress towards peace, measured by reduced war deaths, reduced war injury, progress towards negotiated settlement among the rival factions, the progress towards peace goes up and down almost in lockstep with the number of people who are meditating as a group, radiating this influence of inner peace to become outer peace. When this was subject to mathematical analysis, the likelihood that this is simply due to some fluke, due to chance, is less than one part in 10,000, which for a social scientific experiment is extraordinary. To be able to say something with this certainty that group meditation prevented war, that is a really remarkable finding. The likelihood that this reduction of war was again simply due to chance and not due to the meditating groups was less than one part in 10 million, million, million. There is far more evidence that group meditation can turn off war like a light switch than there is evidence that aspirin reduces headache pain. Aspirin reduces headache. Aspirin reduces headache. Aspirin reduces headache. Aspirin reduces headache.
Can help us here at Occupy Wall.
No problem can be solved at the level of consciousness at which the problem was created.
Put your hand on your heart.
Hand on your heart.
And just ask yourself internally.
And just ask yourself internally.
What kind of world do I want to live in? I want to live in. I want to live in. And now ask yourself.
Now ask yourself,
how
can I make that happen?
How can I make that happen?
A question tonight, can you actually measure the emotional outpouring in a worldwide crisis?
Sometimes scientists think that they have done just that. Their machines and computers found a bizarre pattern right after several global disasters.
CBS News' Brendan Keefe explains this phenomenon.
September 11th deeply affected people far beyond New York and Washington. The attack sent shockwaves around the world, a global reaction that triggered a spike in a network of scientific instruments, just like a seismograph during an earthquake.
Each of those showed a similar pattern of change during that day.
Retired Princeton scientist Dr. Roger Nelson believes the emotional focus of millions of people on a single event like 9/11 may form a global consciousness.
When we have a feeling in our hearts, we're creating electrical and magnetic waves inside of our bodies that extend beyond our bodies into the world around us. And what's so interesting is the research shows that those waves extend not just 1 meter or 2 meters, many, many kilometers beyond where our heart physically resides.
The hour is late. It's time to decide.
Interdependence of all humankind, that we are human only through the humanity of other human beings.
Time evolves and comes to a place where it renews again. There is first a purification time, then there is renewal time. We are getting very close to this time now.
What we need is not division, but is love and wisdom and compassion toward one another.
As we end this great fifth world age and find ourselves now at the beginning of the sixth world age of humankind.
A choice right now
between fear and love.
We can speak about the essential goodness of all human beings. We've been through rough times. The bad, the evil, doesn't have the last word. It's ultimately goodness and laughter and joy and caring and compassion. Those are what are going to prevail in the end.
between fear and love.
Then there is no difficulty in you having a white coat, or he having a red coat, or me having a black coat. These distinctions no longer become such a dominant factor in one's life.
We stand united.
Something right now, we're all gonna die. You understand?
What's the use of saving life when you see what you do with it?
It'll be entering the atmosphere in 40 seconds.
Lilo, you're right. But there are some things, very nice things worth saving, some beautiful things. Beautiful things.
Like love.
Yes, love. That's good. That's a good example. Like love. Love is worth saving.
I don't know love. I was built to protect, not to love. So there's no use for me other than this.
No, you're wrong. I need you. I need you very much.
Why?
Because.
Tell her, Corbin.
Please, don't you need me?
I love you.
Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one.
Thank you.
Scanner imaging has confirmed the dark planet dead.
The planet seems to have stopped at 62 miles from impact.